Hello, I'm Marites Vitug and welcome to Rappler Talk. Joining us is Earl Parreño, an author and political commentator. His latest book, which we will talk about during this interview, is the biography of President Rodrigo Duterte. He will also let us know where you can get hold of this book. It's a very timely, I think, interview because we're going to talk to Earl, who has studied Duterte's leadership in Davao extensively, as he wrote about in the book. Welcome to Rappler Talk, Earl. Thank you for making time.
Yeah, good morning, Marites. Thank you for having me.
Yes, it's very interesting that you wrote this book last year, but now I'm finding it really more very useful. So can you please maybe talk briefly about Duterte's leadership style as mayor, since you looked into this extensively? And is this the same leadership style he's exhibiting now as president?
Yes. I described President Duterte's leadership style as laissez-faire type of leadership, or some call it the delegative type of leadership in management. No? It means that in Davao, he was really hands-off and delegated as many tasks as possible to the heads of the departments. No? He gave department heads free rein to complete tasks in whatever way they please. So you have to be trusted by the president and you have to be competent, no? To be able to do the tasks that he expects you or expected you to do in Davao. Actually, his style of leadership now is the same as when he was mayor of Davao. If you remember, during his first few months in Malacañang, he still wanted to be called mayor. No, most people...
Until today.
Yeah, until today, I think. No, he wanted to be called mayor. He wanted to bring his style of leadership when he was mayor to the office of the president. But obviously, it's different when you're running a country than when you're running a city. When you run a country, you have national defense, you have foreign relations, you have mega development plans and projects to implement that impact a much bigger number of people. So, his type of leadership works best. It's not really bad, but it works best when you have competent people, very competent people, highly experienced. But the problem, I think, now is that the president limited himself only to a very small circle of friends to help him run the country. And I think the problem we are facing now, especially the challenges brought about by this pandemic, is that he has not really chosen the best and the brightest to help him run the government.
So nangyari nga, Earl, ngayon, managing this great crisis, he's relying on a limited circle. So meron pa siyang, when he was mayor of Davao kasi, wala namang gantong kalaking crisis. So ano ba siya? Meron ba siyang, let's say, aversion to experts, to scientists, to... Kasi dito, he got the retired generals to implement the response. Pero yung IATF, kulang pa rin. What do you think about this?
Actually, we should see that at two levels. The first is, your first question is, hindi naman nangyari ito sa Davao. One is because Davao, the LGU in Davao only needed a few dozen people to run the local government. He was able to identify some of the best, some of the brightest people in Davao because it is just a very small city compared to running a country. Then he didn't lack any talent, actually. No, he didn't lack talent to help him run Davao. But when he became president and limited his choice of people to assist him, if you run a national government, you need thousands, more than 10,000 major appointments, actually. So, ang nangyari, parang he relied much on people from he knew previously and people that came from the military or the uniformed services, the military and the police. So, ito yung parang nagkahon sa kanya, no? This choice of people actually impacted how he is running the country now under this great crisis brought about by the pandemic.
Pero Earl, when you looked at him as mayor, was he open to feedback, to criticism? Kasi ang dami namang ang dami namang nagsasuggest, like he listened a bit to the medical frontliners. Tapos si VP Lenny Robredo spoke yesterday, meron din siyang recommendations. But in his response, sabi ni President, don't destroy government. So, hindi siya open to feedback from critics or maybe people he doesn't know.
Yeah. That's another leg sa style of leadership niya, Marites. Na he only listens to people he truly trusts. Pero pag tingin niya opposition ito or tingin niya hindi niya ito tao, hindi niya ito kakampi, he never he does not listen to them, no? In fact, parang tinitignan niya ito as with malice, something that can only result to sa parang ano niya, strengthening the other's position vis-a-vis his position. So ganon, marami siyang mga friends, mga or former friends, no, na nakaaway niya na ganyan yung mga feedback. Hindi siya nakikinig basta kalaban ang nagsasalita.
Doon sa laissez-faire style of leadership ni President Duterte, that works in certain areas kung sabi mo nga in the city, maliit lang, at saka yung areas na hindi siya masyadong interested, economy, lalo na ngayon, no? Education, health, he's not too keen on these issues. So, what makes up, ano yung babawi, what, how can it be improved? Or maybe, what can the cabinet do dito sa kanyang laissez-faire leadership?
I think the cabinet should step up. No, the problem is, there are a number of cabinet members who are not really competent to do their job. No, that's the sad part of it. No, may penchant ang presidente to not just to appoint not just yung mga old friends niya na kilala niya and he thinks loyal sa kanya, but also people coming from the military. Dahil another leg kasi sa style of leadership niya ay yung parang military command style. No? I-order niya lang, actually this is, sa type of leadership, this is the easiest thing to do. You don't have to deliver inspirational speeches to motivate them. No? You just order them. At yun yung isang style niya together with that laissez-faire framework style ay itong military command style, no? It goes hand in hand, no? So namimili siya thinking that the military can be effective in all things having to do with running the government. But of course, we know na mali yon, no? May competence ang military. Wala naman akong ano, wala akong duda dyan. They were trained to do some jobs, no? Fighting war or organizing society, etc. Pero may mga ano talaga, may mga trabaho sa gobyerno. Social welfare, for instance. No? Na hindi mo kaya yan sa isang military training. No? Or running or managing a public health crisis such as this. Hindi yan kaya ng military or police. No? So, he should. Dahil nasa kanya ang ano eh, nasa kanya ang lahat eh. Kaya niya mamili ng best and the brightest to manage a public health issue. Kaya niya mamili ng best and the brightest to manage the economy, no? Amidst this pandemic. Kaya niya mamili ng talents everywhere, maski saan. Ang problem ay linilimit niya ang sarili niya.
Pero, yes. For example, ngayon sa present cabinet, does he listen or yung bang personality ni President, does it scare or intimidate cabinet members to speak up? O makikinig ba siya kung cabinet member niya magsasabi, we're doing it wrong? What's your research on experience mo pala sa Davao? I mean, covering, researching on
May ano na siya, no? May based doon sa research ko sa kanya, may mga sarili na siyang paniniwala sa mga bagay-bagay. Pero naniniwala siya, nakikinig siya sa mga taong close sa kanya, no? Pero at the end, yung sarili niya pa rin ang gusto niyang matupad. So, maski gaano siya i-advise ng mga cabinet members niya, para sa kanya, okay, makinig ako sa inyo, pero ako yung mas susunod. Then secondly, ang mga cabinet members also ay may pag-aalinlangan, karamihan sa kanila, pag-aalinlangan na magpahayag ng totoo nilang damdamin. No? The president has a very strong personality. No? Stronger than all the people surrounding him. No? Kaya, yan. Mas naniniwala kasi si presidente doon sa instincts niya eh. No? He has survived, he has won all the elections, he has survived and managed. Sa totoo lang, he managed Davao relatively well, no, during his mayorship. Para sa kanya, dahil yun sa sarili niyang talent. Hindi yun dahil may advisor siya. No? Hindi naman siya nakikinig sa mga advisors. Eh. Actually, sabi nga sa akin ng ibang close sa kanya, dalawa lang talaga ang pinakinggan ni Presidente noon. Ang isa niyan ay si Nanay Suling at pangalawa ay si Chito Ayala.
No? Oh, but both are dead. Both are gone.
Yeah, unfortunately, both are dead. Chito Ayala parang gave him some competent people to help him manage Davao. Pero yun nga, a few dozen people to run a city compared to thousands of people to run a country, no? So yun yung gap, very very big gap.
Also nabanggit mo sa book, and I think this is a lot of people have observed this, pragmatic, di ba? Pragmatic, yes. Din na politician si President, yes. Duterte, hindi siya ideological, right? Kasi yeah. That's why maybe you can talk a bit about, una, he invited the left to the cabinet, tapos nag-break up sila, wala nang peace talks. So ngayon, he's running after them. So there's no ideology here. So pragmatic talaga siya. So your thoughts on this, Earl?
Yeah. Actually, pragmatism is the third leg, sa fourth leg ng ano niya eh, ng leadership style niya. Ang first leg, as I've said, ay yung laissez-faire approach. Then the second leg ay yung military command style. Then the third leg is pragmatism, no? Pragmatism in relation sa lahat ng policies actually na ginagawa niya, including the left. Para sa kanya kasi, he was he forged a relationship, some say even partnership with the left in Davao, dahil malakas sila eh. They have a very strong military force that could inflict chaos doon sa city na rinaran niya, minamanage niya. Ayaw niya mangyari yun. To hold them at bay, including MILF actually, no? Kailangan niya mag-forge ng ties. And for two decades, nagkaroon ng malalim na relationship niya with the left. Pero nung nandito na siya sa Malacañang, he thought na ang CPP-NPA ay movement lang ito na kaya na ang leaders kaya niya i-entice with government positions. Ang wala sa kanya ay hindi niya naisip na may sariling program for radical social change ang Communist Party. Hindi niya maintindihan ito. So when he offered parang a some sort of a coalition government for them, giving them some cabinet positions, akala niya mai-entice na yung leaders. So na-disappoint niya siya dito. Dahil disappointed siya, then with influence doon sa military na mas nag-strengthen as his administration progress, no, kinalaban niya na ito, no? So ganon, that's pragmatism for him actually.
So Earl, would you consider also his foreign policy pivot to China as part of his pragmatism? Where is that coming from?
Yeah, I think it's both that pragmatism as well as loyalty to France. No, in the case of that pivot, China pivot, I think he's influenced by France, no, who have close ties with China. Many businessmen in Davao have long been doing business with mainland Chinese. No, so they naturally see China from a perspective of a trading partner, not a threat to our sovereignty. At itong mga friends niya, who are loyal actually to him, no, I think he listens to or nakaka-impluensya sa kanya. So it's most pragmatism. Totoo yun eh, yung sinasabi niyang, wala naman akong barko or arms na ipanlaban sa China. That's the pragmatic part, no? Or we could get loans, no, from China for his build program, no? So that's the pragmatic side of it. But the loyalty ay nanggagaling naman doon sa mga friends niya, businessmen friends niya from Davao, no? Na nag-a-advise sa kanya na mas makikinabang ang bansa if we have more Chinese investors coming in.
How did he get close? I read in your book, Earl, very interesting, that he didn't want to be ignored by the businessmen, the Chinese business community. So he stopped traffic in the center of the city. And after that, nag-complain yung mga businessmen. And then from then on, naging allies na niya.
Yeah.
I mean, so how did he become close to this Chinese-Filipino businessman in Davao?
Kasi si Presidente, kasi when he was mayor, parang amiable yun siya sa lahat ng mga tao. Wag lang parang formal ka masyado, at karamihan mga Chinese businessmen sa Davao ay hindi naman ganun ka formal eh. So mas madali siyang personal na nakapag-create ng relationship. Then Davao is a very small place. Kilala ng bawat tao ang isa't isa, no? They isa lang yung tambayan nila. So madaling mag-forge ng personal ties. Yung bago siya nag-mayor kasi, tatlo lang actually sumuporta sa kanya sa campaign, no? Tatlong Chinese, no, ang sumuporta sa kanya. Ang iba dahil takot sa administration noon ay talagang nag-distance sa kanya. So, pero ayaw niya naman, siguro political instinct yun, ayaw niya kalabanin itong mga taong hindi sumuporta sa kanya dahil alam niya na napilitan lang ito, no, na mag-distance sa kanya. So, nagpakilala nga siya by stopping traffic doon sa lugar na may majority ng warehouses ay located doon, malapit sa port, no? Siyempre, hindi makapagbaba, hindi makapag-load, hindi makapag-unload ang mga Chinese traders doon. So, kailangan kausapin ang City Hall. And it started the friendship with these business people.
Yeah, I was just going to tell our viewers na for details kung sino yung mga yon, you should read the book. But wait, one more. One or two more questions, Earl, before we end. Ito pang the president has been in Davao since August 3 this month, no? So, yeah. I remember in Davao, ganun din, di ba, matagal din siyang nawawala or nagbabakasyon ba or he wouldn't be seen. So naging issue ba ang health niya sa Davao or naging issue ba itong vacations niya sa Davao?
Hindi naman talaga naging issue yung pag nawawala siya. Maraming beses siya nawawala, no? From is not seen publicly or maski sa media, no? Maraming beses 'yon. Pero yung mga people close to him ay may access pa rin sa kanya. Kaya walang mga kwento-kwento na baka nagkasakit siya dahil may access sa kanya eh. Maski ngayon eh, I have friends na sasabi, galing lang ako sa Davao, kararating ko lang, nagkita kami ni Presidente. Maski nung first week, nung pumunta siyang Davao. No? So, I think nandoon siya, ayaw niya magpakita publicly. And I think, of course, tumatanda din yung Presidente, no? At naglulong, sa tingin ko, naglulong siya na mabigyan siya ng space, no? Away from the limelight ng public office niya. So, ayaw niya makipag-usap ng maski kanino. At tingin ko ganun yung it explains yung mga long absences niya from public eye.
I see. So kasi ngayon as we speak, di ba, the days a few days ago, mga rumors ng health niya. So never naman naging issue ang health niya when he was mayor of Davao, but kasi now he's president, so mas malaki ang role niya. So that's why people are asking about his health. So noon naman you were doing your research, health wasn't an issue, was it? when he was mayor.
It was not an issue, but frankly, matanda na siya, he's not as healthy as he was before. And even now, ina-acknowledge niya naman yon na may mga sakit-sakit na yung katawan niya. Pero is it really a matter of life and death? Is it a debilitating disease? I don't think so. No? Ito yung ano, ito yung parang nararamdaman ng katawan pag nag-i-age ka na. No? And I think people around him, especially the PSG and our health service, are really monitoring closely his health. Kaya I don't think na may mangyaring ano no, masama sa kanya dahil hindi na mo-monitor ang health niya. Of one course, just ang nakakaalam niya.
Yeah. One final question, Earl, no? On transparency, kasi I listened to him speak this morning and he talked about, you know, that walang corruption, everything will be accounted for. Kasi yung transparency, madali, kung gusto ng gobyerno, maglagay sila ng online portal, lahat ng donations, funds, COVID-related, lagay mo kung saan pumunta, parang nangyari nung Hayan. Meron ba siyang aversion sa transparency? Kasi wala pang, hindi pa ito ginagawa ng gobyerno. There's no one portal or database you could go to look at all the funds. And he's been very, sabi niya, wala daw corruption, but ano bang stand niya sa transparency? Sa Davao, open ba lahat? Mga data at the time?
Yeah, sa pagkakaalam ko, very transparent naman ang transaction sa Davao. Dito, I think, again, nabla-blindside siya ng ibang cabinet members talaga. I have parang mga stories, kwento sa akin na some of his close parang advisors ay may mga ginagawang magic doon sa mga funds. Ano? And I think, in fact, sa tingin ko, parang pinapa-imbestigahan niya to silently, no? Dahil ayaw niya nga talaga magamit ito, no, against sa administration niya. Pero kung ilalabas niya to later on, I think so, ilalabas niya to later on.
Ay, before we go pala, nakalimutan ko kasi you said three legs of his leadership, but there are four. Ano yung fourth leg? Yeah.
Yung friendship niya. One is the laissez-faire approach, then the
military command.
Yung military command, then yung third, yung pagiging pragmatic in everything, then loyalty sa friends. Ito yung four legs na yung style of leadership niya stands on.
Okay. Thank you so much. But before we end the interview, Earl, where can they... our viewers get this book? Is there an online version?
Or yeah, you could search that sa Lazada, sa Shopee, no? Pag ano, dinideliver sa inyo.
Wow, okay. Good na, nandun na siya sa online shops. Thank you very much, Earl, for making time for this interview. And we hope our listeners and viewers were able to gain insights on the leadership style of President Duterte, especially now that we're going through a public health crisis and a global pandemic. Thank you, and we will continue this conversation in the future.